Temp check. What kind of summer are we having this year? A family road trip summer? A beach bum summer? Or a wake me up when the sun sets summer? With Instacart, choose your own adventure and skip the shopping side quests. Where available, you can get ice cream delivered to your hotel, sunscreen to the pool, or cold brew to your bed. Well, door, in as fast as 30 minutes. Wherever you find yourself this summer, you can get the goods. Download Instacart for free delivery on your first three orders. Offer valid for a limited time. Minimum $10 per order. Excludes restaurants. Additional terms and fees apply.
This podcast is brought to you by eHarmony, the dating app to find someone you can be yourself with. Why doesn't eHarmony allow copy and paste in first messages? Because you are unique, and your conversations should reflect that. eHarmony wants you to find someone who will get you. How are you going to know who gets you if people send you the same generic conversation starters they message everyone else? Conversations that actually help you get to know each other. Imagine that. Get who gets you on eHarmony. Sign up today.
Edit audio.
Hello, everyone. I'm Robin Hopkins, and this is Well Adjusting, where I talk to people about life stuff, but not in an NPR way. It's more like we're at the bar, having cocktails, getting into your business sort of way.
It's giving drunk NPR.
Oh, and producer Steph is here, too.
Hello.
Today we chat, well, finances for freelancers. Hi, friends. I am so excited for today's episode because we are doing something a little different. So today, my pal Brian Leitten is joining us to talk about how to approach your finances when you're a freelancer. When you don't have the security of a consistent gig, when you don't have a corporate overlord offering you insurance and 401k, you have to take matters into your own hands. Well, you don't have to, but if you don't, life may get a little bit stressful. So, Brian and I are talking about some tips to help you navigate the waters of saving, investing, and taking care of you. Oh, and you are going to want to stay for this entire episode because we also have Kara Stevens, aka the Frugal Feminista, and she's coming in at the end of the episode to offer some wisdom on how to make sure you ask for what you're worth in the freelance market. So let's do this.
Sure, my name's Brian Leitten, and I'm a producer, director, writer, editor, camera operator.
And my former intern. Why do you leave that part out?
Yeah, Robin was my internship director in my senior year of college.
So normally we bring somebody in, you know, in the middle of a problem. But you and I were, again, having drinks years and years and years later. And we were talking about, we were like completely geeking out over finances and 401ks and freelance stuff. And of course, like, life is life content, or is content life? It's hard to say at this point. I was like, oh, come be on Well Adjusting and let's talk about the life of a freelancer and finances.
That in and of itself is a problem. So plenty right? of problems
it's
to talk
true,
about.
It is. Well, so like, I want to hear just a little bit before we start talking about like, because ultimately we're going to be talking about some tips, right? But I want to hear a little bit. Can you just like tell people a little bit about your journey from corporate to freelance and like some of the hurdles and what you had to kind of, how you had to kind of get your ducks in a row?
Realistically, I've had two of those journeys. The first one was in 2008 when I left MTV after 6 years of corporate work, full-time job, pension plan, and health insurance.
Remember that
all
pension?
The bells and
that
whistles.
Was good. Yeah.
Yeah, I got a little $5,000 paycheck after 5 years or 6 years. I'm pretty sure I put that into a 401k.
A rollover 401k?
It might have been a Roth IRA or an IRA because I didn't know about Roths at the time. We'll get to that later. And I started working on a show called Made on MTV, which on that show, you're a freelancer. The good part is I came in the eighth season and worked to the 12th season. So I had a steady work for 4 years. But there were times where we were in between seasons or there just wasn't a show ready to go. So I would have to go dark for 2 weeks, a month, 2 months. And that's when you have to start thinking about you don't have a paycheck coming in every week.
Yeah.
And that's the most difficult thing to think about. And it's really like a mindset change that I didn't truly get when I worked on Made because it was so permalance, permanently yeah. freelancing.
There is, you can get lulled into confident into the belief that like, oh, this is going to go on forever. Like I have one of those, like I have a, like a permalance thing right now too. And I'm living in yeah. fear that I'm going to get that call. That's like, oh, hey, we're not doing that show anymore. And then I'm like, oh.
Yeah. And there's kind of like a permalance with clients too. I've had currently my two biggest clients I've had for 5 or 6 years. And one of them, their stock dropped and their CEO started cutting. And the first place to cut was the video team.
Yeah.
So a lot of people internally lost their jobs and I haven't had any work from them in 6 months.
Oof.
And they were a six-figure client for the last 5 or 6 years.
Yeah.
So the second time I went freelance was 2017. I left, I did 5 years at Vivo as a director of production and executive producer. And then I left that to join a small production company. That didn't work out. And I left that job. And within a month, I left New York.
Oh.
15 years. I boxed up my life, put it in a storage bin, and lived by choice out of my car for about 2 years.
I was going to say, I feel like there was a point in time where you were like showering at the gym. And I was like, Brian, what are we doing here? And you were like, no, this is good. You're like, I love this. I'm like, you're like, I bought a place in Miami. I'm doing this. And I was like, okay, we're good. I was like, we're good. Right.
I was everywhere. I purposefully lived in my Subaru Forester. I always wanted to do that drive across country road trip. I ended up doing it about 12 times crossing the country, but it was a conscious choice I made to try some new stuff and to live a different lifestyle. So I had work. It wasn't that I wasn't working. I got a massive tax refund and I was a great saver and I was working. I drove across country for the first 2 weeks. I left New York and then I flew to China and worked for a month. And then I came back and I had film festivals I was going to. I was teaching outdoor filmmaking. I came back to New York for work. I went to Jordan for work. I went to India for work. I had work in Miami, but it was not enough work. I was skating by for like 3 years up until the pandemic.
Oh, really? Right up to the pandemic?
Yeah, I would say November of 2019 was when everything started going really well.
Yeah. Oh, great timing.
Yeah, a couple of new clients. I started working on the Bloomberg campaign for 6 weeks before the president or the presidential election. And he was just spending. And it was great. I traveled to 25, 30 cities in 6 weeks. And I had another client I was working for. And somehow I didn't get COVID because that was January, February, March. And then everything came crashing down.
Yeah.
And I didn't really work from April of 2020 to December of 2020 at all. No money, except for government subsidies.
Which we were all very thankful for them, by the way, at that time, for sure. Because I had just quit my job, too, when COVID started. And I was like, I'm going to go make this leap into the freelance world. And that was December 2019. And I was like, burr, 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 burr. I was like, high unemployment.
Perfect timing.
But, you know, it's like one of the things that you and I have in common is that we're both very methodical and thoughtful and just a tad bit obsessive about money. And about whether we save or where it goes or putting it places or we're always talking about it. And we're always like, we're both the type of people who are like projecting. We're like, if I get this much, I take this and I can put this here. And so it's like, we've always like connected there. But like, I'm curious, like
I think I got that from you.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
No, it's a good thing. As an assistant, I was probably saving or putting more money into a 401k than some of the vice presidents that we
Yeah, I was
with.
Like, Brian, what are you doing? I was like, you got to up that number. I was like, you can do it. I know you're overtime.
Yeah, you start at 5% and you get that company match. And every time you get a raise, you up that like amount you put in till you max out. And at some point,
I'm crying. I'm
the
so
money
proud.
Gets taken away before you even see it. So you don't even realize what you're losing.
Yeah.
But you're not losing it. You're just gaining it in the future.
Want to teach your kids financial literacy, but not sure where to start? Greenlight can help. With Greenlight, parents can keep an eye on kids' spending and saving, while kids and teens use a card of their own to build money confidence. As a parent, you can send instant money transfers, set up chores, automate allowance, and more. It's a convenient way to run your household, customized to your family's needs, and the easy way to raise financially smart kids. Get started with Greenlight today and get your first month free at greenlight.com/wondery.
Okay, it's time to commit. 2024 is the year for prioritizing yourself. Begin your new smile journey with Byte, and you could start seeing results in just 2 to 3 weeks. Just order your at-home impression kit today for only $14.95 at Byte.com. Byte clear liners are doctor-directed and delivered to your door. Treatment costs thousands less than braces, plus they offer financing options, accept eligible insurance, and you could pay with your HSA, FSA. Get 80% off your impression kit when you use code WONDERY at Byte.com. That's B-Y-T-E.com. Start your confidence journey today with Byte.
Okay, picture this. It's Friday afternoon when a thought hits you. I can spend another weekend doing the same old whatever, or I can hop into my all-new Hyundai Santa Fe and hit the road. With available H-Track all-wheel drive and three-row seating, my whole family can head deep into the wild. Conquer the weekend in the all-new Hyundai Santa Fe. Visit HyundaiUSA.com or call 562-314-4603 for more details. Hyundai, there's joy in every journey.
When do you think like your mentality, but you also had some, like, you watched your dad have some money issues or your family have some money issues. And I think that was impactful as well in your mentality.
Yeah, of course. My father got moved around from job to job for a while. And then there was a time where he didn't have work and he needed to take money out of his 401k. My mom got cancer, which was a big hit, and they weren't prepared for that. And, you know, I don't know the financials of it, but I think that definitely took a hit.
Yeah.
But I grew up not wanting for a thing ever. I probably should have wanted a little more in the long run. But yeah, it's just one of those things where all of a sudden you notice, oh, like, I should start doing some of these things because it'll have an impact on my future now.
Yeah.
As opposed to, you know, waiting until later. And the advantage for me is, you know, by this time, my parents had three teenagers.
Yeah.
And they were paying for three teenagers. And I don't have children.
So much money.
And I don't own a house.
Yeah.
And my car is paid off. So my finances are pretty locked in. I had back surgery 3 years ago. And I couldn't really do much for a month or two. So I just watched like 1,000 finance videos on YouTube and did a ton of research.
Yeah, because you, like, by this last time I saw you, you've leveled up the way that you talk about money. Like, you leveled it up. But before you go there, because I want to ask you, like, coming in and out of corporate to freelance, can you talk a little bit about the mentality? Because you were like, I'm going to live in my car. I want to do this. You have always said, I want to travel. I want to do this. How did you figure out, okay, then that means I'm going to need to save this? Like, I mean, like, walk me through the steps that you would say, like, I want to prioritize a trip to India for 2 months and I've got to figure out what my locked costs are. Like, how do you approach that?
Yeah. I think I got lucky because when I started freelancing, I had such a permanent freelance job.
Mm-hmm.
So over the course of four
super
years,
super helpful,
very helpful. Little things would pop up when I had to go dark for 2 months and I didn't have money coming in. And I start to think like, oh, I should have saved a little bit each paycheck in case this happens. And then you start like kind of keeping a mental note of all those things. And this past time going freelance, it's, as a freelancer, you should be thinking about money all the time. It should affect every part of your life without letting it control every part of your life. And when I look at figuring out my money, I have a budget. I've had a budget at least for 15 years of my life, if not longer. You know, it gets to a point when you know where you're spending your money. So it's, I'm not like updating it every day.
Yeah, that's where I am too.
But I did update it in January when I realized a six-figure client might not come back this year.
Yeah.
So I started looking at where I was spending my money the most, corporate, my company and my person. And I started dialing things back. I got rid of Adobe Premiere I was paying $60 a month for. I stopped spending a little bit of frivolous money here and there and just kind of reframed what this year would look like. And I know my expenses. I know how much I need to make. So I'm looking at that number. I'm adding 25% to it and saying, like, this is my money for the year. This is what I need to hit.
What do you mean by you're adding 25%? You mean like you have your hard costs?
For taxes.
Like your rent? Oh, okay. So you're okay. So you're setting aside 25% for taxes of everything that comes in.
Yep.
I set 30% aside because I get nervous, but yeah.
My taxes are pretty dialed in. I have someone else do them for me just because almost everything I do goes through my company.
Yeah.
So there's just a lot of line items. So I pay someone to do that is well worth it. I understand my taxes, though. I can go through the sheet and reference back to my profit and loss statement in mm-hmm. QuickBooks and understand, like, that's that line item. Like, knowing your taxes last year saved me $1,400. Because in 2022, I wasn't paying my taxes quarterly. So you get, like, an automatic fee for not paying your taxes quarterly of, like, $200 or $300 from the government. It's just a fee for not doing it. And then you pay interest on each quarter. And I had a really good Q1 in 2022. So I was paying interest on the taxes I didn't pay quarterly. So at the end of the year, it totaled $1,400. I saw that line item when I went through my taxes and I asked my tax person, would I get to keep this $1,400 if I just pay quarterly? And she said, yes. And I said, that's what I want to do. So now I pay my taxes quarterly.
You're bringing up two interesting things. One is that I want to come back to, but the first is I think it's really important to, like, I have this thing. Everybody's heard me talk about the Great Robin plan. That's my, like, dreaming plan. But I also have a financial notes document that I keep for the family. And it earmarks where all our money is. And I have accounts where I can say where I'm saving money. Like somebody just had to get braces. So I knew that was coming. And so I had a line item in this one savings account. And I marked $4,500 was saved for the braces. And whatever was in that savings account, everything was market. Like, I knew exactly what it was earmarked for. And so, like,
you're better than me. I don't do that.
I also am more obsessive than you. So there's that. But
a little bit,
when it comes to the money, all things. But keeping records of these things, like I love an archive mm-hmm. and a document, because I think that, like, I keep my major expenses, like kids' summer camps and things like that, so that I can be thinking about it for next year. So, like, that learning that you had about the taxes, that'll probably stay with you, but other things may not. And so just having a place where you, like, a central document where you can, like, note things down.
I have a couple of those.
Yeah, you got a lot of nerve saying you're worse. I'm worse than you. But you know,
I took a trip to Europe and Africa for 3 weeks, and I didn't set, like, I knew I had the money for it, but I didn't earmark or put money into a separate account. I just kind of tracked what I was spending on a note in my phone and my computer because they're connected. And I literally kept track of every single thing I purchased. So I know, like, oh, on a per day average, my trip cost $462.
That's amazing.
But I do have a money note in my phone, and it's like, right, and it changes every month. Right now it says June money, credit cards, utilities, rent, health insurance, life insurance, car insurance. And then it has what I should have paid in my Q1 taxes, what I think I'm paying in my Q2 taxes, the amount of money I can still put into my 401k as myself and as my company. It has, like, my two outstanding payments for the work I've done this year. So I kind of can track that on a daily basis. And then I have a Google Doc that has, like, a quarterly tracking of my net worth of all my accounts going back to, I think I started it in 2012. So I can look at the last 12 years of my, like, financial journey and see how it's changed.
That's incredible.
And how it's grown.
That's incredible. And I think what we're pointing out, because I think what I want to do in this episode is I just want to highlight some of the things we're saying, because I think a lot of these terms can be coming at you and there's a lot. But so like keeping records, and you can hear how Brian's records are totally different from my records. Like I have one doc and I of course have it sectioned because that's what works for me, like with little sheets per account. So it's like keeping records and like dialing it into what you need. But there are some things that probably should be on it. What are your hard and your fixed costs? When are they due? And what are your projected expenses so that you can be saving for them? Whether you keep it all in one account, like my idiosyncrasy of keeping them in separate accounts is just because I like that's in one pocket, that's in another pocket. Mm. That is just a weird little thing I do.
I have three.
Yeah.
I have my personal checking, my personal savings, and then my business bank account.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah.
So just like, I think starting with a document with like hard costs, projected costs, and that's a great place to start. But then I wanted to circle back to something that you say. So you're referencing like as a freelancer, and I think a lot of people don't understand this, you own a business. So, and I actually have the same thing. I have an LLC, and that's all the work that I do as an actor or as a freelancer, I bill through that. And then that allows me to do certain things. So I'd love to hear about your setup with that. And if you could talk a little bit about maybe about why you do that.
Yeah. So my production company is called Hyperion 13. And it really just allows you to write off a lot more than you would if I was doing business as Hyperion 13. At the end of the day, because I'm a sole proprietor LLC, I'm doing my taxes as Brian Leitten.
Which means that's just one person in the LLC. I have no employees. I have a sole proprietor as well. It's just, I got no employees.
Correct.
It's just me. And it's a pass-through, which means I don't have to file taxes for my business. It all gets filed under Robin Hopkins. So just for that clarification.
I mean, I think I did this company in 2010 or 2011 because I was going through am I going to keep working at Made? Am I going to do my own thing? And someone told me, start a business. I'll give you like tax deductions. It'll help you track everything you're doing properly. And it really has. I pay for QuickBooks. Everything goes through QuickBooks.
Yeah. I mean, QuickBooks is not a sponsor, but they should be because it's so good. It's so easy. It's so user-friendly. And it is a great tracking tool to see how you're doing.
Yeah. And I think for me, it allowed, like setting up the business gives you a little bit of a professional cachet. You have a website, you have a business card you can hand out. You have a place, whether it's social media or the website, to direct people to see what you do as a business and as a person. And for me, I don't think I get a lot of work from people visiting my website, but the people that hire me visit my website.
Yeah.
So I'm not getting cold calls or cold emails from my site, but every time someone wants to hire me or someone is checking in on me, they're like, man, I love your website. Your website's so good. And I haven't updated my website since 2018.
Yeah.
I haven't updated my production reel since 2018.
Yeah.
But, you know, all of this comes back to setting yourself up as a successful business and understanding.
Yeah.
You know, what's going to drop your taxes, what's you can write off, how long your money has to last for. Because as a freelancer, you don't have that steady every 2 week paycheck. You don't have a company that's subsidizing part of your Social Security taxes or your FICA taxes. You don't have a company that's subsidizing your health insurance. You don't have a company that's subsidizing your vacation.
Yeah.
So those are all things that you have to plan for and budget for on top of your day-to-day expenses.
Yeah.
So there's a massive mindset of the freelance world versus the 1099 world versus the W-2 world.
Yeah. But I just, the mentality is everything. The mentality is everything. Like I'm just off of vacation with my family and I had to pre-save because I did not get paid that week. And I know I'm going to be dark for my paying gig in August. So I have to save ahead all of the money for August so that we still have, because my expenses don't change. And so it is, I do think that that part about freelance can be a little stressful, but like if you can embrace it as like, I got a doc, when money comes in, I'm taking out these percentages and this is what I can live on, and embrace a budget, it's helpful. But that there does need to be a mentality shift.
Yeah, you're talking about August. I'm thinking about December, like all the way through December.
Plug in a Hyundai EV and the extraordinary happens. From the charge time and range in the Ioniq 5 and 6 to the adventurous spirit of the Kona Electric to the 601 horsepower Ioniq 5N. Hyundai EVs make the extraordinary electrifying. There's joy in every journey.
EPA estimated 303-mile driving range for 2024 Ioniq 5 SE SEL limited rear-wheel drive and 361-mile driving range for 2024 Ioniq 6 SE long-range rear-wheel drive with fully charged battery. Actual range may vary. Visit HyundaiUSA.com or call 562-314-4603 for more details.
Explore the endless bounds of space with all-new LEGO building sets. From engineering wonders like LEGO Technic NASA Apollo Lunar Roving Vehicle to astronaut dog walkers, there is a perfect LEGO set for everyone on Earth. First launched in 1978, space sets have been igniting people's curiosity through the ultimate creative medium of LEGO bricks. Their newest collection is sure to propel the wonder for exploration and adventure across the galaxies. Be inspired by LEGO sets that are out of this world. Visit amazon.com/LEGO space to see the full collection.
Plug in a Hyundai EV and the extraordinary happens. From the charge time and range in the Ioniq 5 and 6 to the adventurous spirit of the Kona Electric to the 601 horsepower Ioniq 5N. Hyundai EVs make the extraordinary electrifying. There's joy in every journey.
EPA estimated 303-mile driving range for 2024 Ioniq 5 SE SEL limited rear-wheel drive and 361-mile driving range for 2024 Ioniq 6 SE long-range rear-wheel drive with fully charged battery. Actual range may vary. Visit HyundaiUSA.com or call 562-314-4603 for more details.
You know, we're talking about you have to have the mentality to save ahead. You have to set your business up properly. You need to make sure you're documenting all of the things. But then there's like this whole idea, like, you know, like you forget. Corporations, whether right or wrong in America, they are tasked with helping you with your retirement, helping you with your health insurance. And so it's like what started us, me being like, come be on the podcast, was I didn't know I could have a solo 401k on my own, a 401k setup. I had no idea I was able to do that. I thought I could only do an IRA. And if you make too much money, you know, like you can't put it in there. And I was like, how am I going to retire only being able to save like $7,000 a year in some Roth IRA? And you were like, dummy, you can do a solo 401k. And I was like,
I don't think
okay?
I said dummy.
No, you didn't. In my head, I did though. I was like, what?
Well, so maybe this could be where I jump in as a Canadian who is newly living in the United States. I want to know, what is the difference between a Roth IRA and a 401k?
Good question.
We'll go down the list. So we'll start with an IRA. An IRA is you pay your taxes on the money. You put the money in an IRA. You pay your taxes when you take it out in retirement. A Roth IRA, you put the money in the account and you pay your taxes now. And it never, ever gets taxed again. So you have to play this game of, will I pay more in it in my taxes now or when I'm 70? And it's kind of a guessing game.
Yeah.
So my mentality has always been, if I have a really great year, I just pay the taxes now. If I am truly not worrying about money, pay the taxes now, just never have to worry about it again. And pretty much most retirement accounts work the same way. So a 401k, I believe in 2024, you can put in personally $23,000.
If you have an LLC.
Yes, if you have an LLC, which is the same, the amount of money you can put in a 401k is the same as if you were working.
That's true. I'm sorry, as in a corporation, yeah.
Yeah, so that is, depending on how you decide, you can have a Roth 401k. I have a Roth 401k
regular
401k. So again, you're making that decision of, do I pay the taxes on it now or do I pay the taxes on it later?
I think the distinction for Canadian staff is an IRA is an individual retirement account, hence the IRA. A 401k is usually a corporate
a corporate-backed retirement account. And the idea is that, like, the corporation is they're usually doing it to offset profits. But so they you put in whatever percentage of your gross, and then they match it up to a certain percent. So if I put in up 5% of my paycheck, they'll match it up to 5%. And so it's a retirement vehicle that your corporation owns. So in theory, if you are a freelancer and not working for a company, and this was my erroneous thinking, I was like, oh, I can only have an IRA, which, you know, there is limitations on how much you are allowed to put in based on how much you make. And then the Roth distinction happens across all the types of retirement vehicles. It's just paying the taxes now or later. If I put in $1 million into a 401k, I'd put it in pre-taxed. So my check was $500. They took 10% of it and put it into my 401k. They put in $500. Now that $500 is going to grow over 20 years. And then when I take it out, let's say it's $2,000, I now have to pay taxes on $2,000. But if I make it as a Roth contribution, I'm not getting the pre-tax benefit now, but I'm paying it when it's only valued at $500. So when it grows to $2,000, I only pay taxes on $500. So whenever you can, you know, like, but Brian's point is, like, the money people will start to get into these, like my financial advisor will get into all these, like, splitting hairs. And it's you're talking about $1,000 difference. And I get all like, yeah. I don't care. Because he'll be like, if you have a down year, that's when you want to pay, do put into Roth. Because if you have a down year, you're going to pay less taxes and it's still going to grow. And I'm like, who can think about those levels of distinctions? Yeah. Money guys.
Yeah. And with a Roth IRA, once you make a certain amount of money, you can't contribute to a Roth IRA anymore.
Right. Like I was like, the max you can do is like 7,000 or maybe 7,500 if it's a catch up over a certain age. Like once you hit 50, they allow you to put a little more in because they know you're panicked about retirement. But this year I could only put in $800 into my Roth. And that's when I panicked because I made too much money. So it drops down.
But at the same time, you can put the difference into a regular IRA. So if you made too much money, like the last couple of years, I've made too much money to put money into a Roth IRA. So I could just put it in a regular IRA.
Right. But then my money guy's going to tell you you're going to pay the taxes on that twice.
But then why are you putting it in a IRA to begin with? Why don't you just put it in like a high savings account?
Oh my God, Steph, no, because you're going to have compounding interest over time at like it's an investment fund. An IRA is being managed by somebody. Like you're like they often are tied to like target-based retirement. Like that's what I always choose is the target-based retirement. So like I have a 401k for my old job that's being managed by a company. Like Vanguard manages it. I choose a target date retirement fund. And so the younger you are, the more aggressive they're going to invest. And then as you get closer to retirement, they start backing off. But during those younger years, like they're going hard and you might make 10%, 12% returns. I put like, let's just say I put in, I don't know, and this isn't a fact. Let's say I put in $100 during my time at Viacom, like 30 years ago. I'm telling you that money that I put in is now worth 7 times what I put in. You're never going to get that in a high yield.
And you're only paying taxes on what you take out when you get older. Right. So you say like, if you start early, the most important thing is to do all these things.
Start early.
Is to start early and to do these things. You might not max out every year, but the fact that if you start at 20 and you retire at 70, that's 50 years of your money compounding without paying taxes on it or, you know, when it's in the account. But if I put that money into a high yield savings account at 5-6% that you can get right now, as opposed to my 401k, if whatever money that high yield savings account makes, I'm paying taxes on that as capital gains tax at the end of the year. Maybe not capital gains tax, but I'm paying taxes on it. It's a profit.
It's income.
But yeah, with a regular, whatever the count is, it builds and builds and builds, and you never pay taxes until you take that money out. So you get that compounding interest. Like I just automatically reinvest my dividends. So you don't pay taxes on those dividend profits because you're reinvesting them. And that helps your money grow even more.
Like Susie Orman talks about this, and I wish I had the exact figure. I'll put it in the show notes. But she talks about if you start investing, it's something like $100 a month or $300 a month in your 401k in your early 20s, you will have $1 million by the time you retire. Like, it's such a low number. I want to say it's like $100 a month. If you start when you are 45 or 50, you will have like 100,000. It is like such a, I'm going to get the exact numbers, but it's such a stark comparison of when you start and what you're putting in. So it's like just turning it on. I had 3 years when I was at MTV when I first started, when they made me staff. And I was like, I'm not turning on that 401k. I was like, I'm going to be famous real soon.
You lost $12,000 by
in 3 years.
That.
Yeah. More than that, probably.
I have a lot of thoughts. I think that these like systems exist in other countries in similar ways, but are called different things. So mm-hmm. it's not so much that. It's like more around the wording of like the language used for them. But I do think that to a certain level, if you haven't saved any money ever, this all sounds so scary and so far away.
Yes.
And also kind of like embarrassing. Like you have to have like a moment where you're like reconcile, like you like reckon with yourself to be like, okay, like before I go to the bank and do that little test about how risky I want my $5 to be invested every month, I have to like admit that I have to go do that, you know? So yeah. I guess that's sort of my like last question is if you were someone that was like listening to this and this was like your first foray into even thinking about this, like, what's one or two things that you could do?
I would say the first thing you need to do is a budget, a line by line budget. Go through your credit card statements, go through your bank statements, and figure out what you're spending on entertainment, on food, on subscriptions. If you have a business, like doing the same thing. If you have QuickBooks, it helps. It organizes everything for you.
But there's also so many apps like Rocket Money and all those mm-hmm. kinds of things that will help you look at your you know, you can input everything into it and yeah. they'll be like, this is what you spend on entertainment.
You have to understand your spending first. Yeah. That's the very first thing, is understanding where your money goes. And then you can add to that, where else should my money go? First thing I would say is once you know that number, like, your monthly number, if you need $5,000 to survive and pay your taxes, the first thing I would say is you need a 6-month savings account, safety net. 6 months of money in case you lose your job, something happens, you want to quit your job because you hate it. You have an emergency fund of 6 months of all your money set aside.
Yeah.
That would be the first thing. While simultaneously trying to pay down your highest interest debt, which is usually a credit card.
And this is the moment where if you are scared, your pants are off, you're that scared, I want you to hit pause and I want you to go back to our very first episode with Aileen. We talk all about the process of like the emotions of getting out of debt and building your finances. And I want to tell you,
it's emotional.
I had a half an hour conversation with Aileen yesterday. This is 2 years later. She is 100% credit card debt free. She has paid off her cars. She has saved for her kids' wedding. And she is very close to paying off her mortgage. Like 2 years.
That's a plan.
Like she changed her approach to money. Like, because I think that that's something we talk about always, is that being positive around money and just slowly chunking away at it. Like, these little things that you do over time make huge differences. So it's not so much the one thing you do, it's that you do something.
Yep.
Don't beat yourself up. You start when you start and just start. And then I just want to say thank you to Brian for being willing to come and chat about your finances and about the glory days, the salad days, as we call them. Thank you so much. This was delightful. And hopefully we didn't scare the pants off everyone. But like I said, stay tuned, because we've got an expert of the day that's going to wow you.
You have reached the well-adjusting expert of the day.
My name is Kara Stevens, and I'm founder of the Frugal Feminista. And we help all types of people heal their relationship with money. I think that for a lot of us, pricing is a huge barrier to allowing us to get as much money as we can, because we look at the conversation and the idea around negotiating as this life or death, all or nothing thing. So I think the first step in understanding pricing and negotiation is that a negotiation is just that, it's a back and forth. Rarely will it be a conversation of like, hey, take it or leave it. And if it is that type of conversation, it might be good in the long run that you don't have that person as a client. And I know when money is tight, you may not want to hear that. But when you think about the quality of partnership you want in a client and repeat clients, seeing how they behave during negotiations is a key part of the negotiation process. So as a larger piece, just knowing that there's rarely all or nothing approach to negotiation. I would say number two is think really clearly about your lifestyle and what you want in terms of money. And what I mean by that is sometimes we look at what other people are charging, or we look at what we might have done in the past. But I think being able to look at what your goals are financially at the end of each month, at the end of each year, at the end of each quarter, will help you backwards design what your pricing may be. I think that for a lot of us, when we are freelancers, it's overwhelming. We're just taking gigs as they come. But if we slow down, we actually speed up. And by that, I mean is if I decide I want to make, say, $10,000 by the end of the month, and you want to have more time freedom, then you may create a higher cost package. And rather than think that that's not possible, what you do is just add more value to what you're offering and reduce the number of clients that you serve. And that might not happen overnight, but all you need is one to give you the quick win to let you know there could be another one. So I would say that's another big piece. And that worked for me. Just in my personal experience, I wanted to quit the Frugal Feminista because I felt like all I did was freelance and I was hand to mouth every month starting at zero. And I was overworked. And so in identifying what did I want my revenue goal to be and how I wanted to get there really helped me get clear about my target audience or my target client and then how I wanted to serve them. So I would think also as a third piece, which is kind of related, is look at what your offers are and see how you can enhance them to justify a higher price. So is it turnaround? Is it exclusivity? You know, is it packaging? Is it more hands-on? And by adding those extra elements of value to your client, you're able to be able to translate that value and be able to have it make sense and translate to the right client. And I would also say that the emotional component of it is a key part of kind of knowing your worth as a freelancer. And how I've been able to support others and support myself is I systematize my emotions. Knowing that I feel how I'm going to feel, what I do is sometimes I schedule emails to be sent later after I write them because I'm afraid to press send. So I build systems in to send it while I'm taking a shower, send it while I'm sleeping. So it's done is done. Or if you have an assistant, have the assistant do it and make it a little bit more distant from you. And I would say even in addition to that, what I find is the follow-up as well is a key part of negotiating or having more money as a freelancer or as a business owner is being comfortable with silence for a while and then being comfortable with a follow-up. And so I think those are some of the big pieces that I have been able to support myself and others with, really understanding that the journey when it comes to money as a solopreneur, as a freelancer, is something that we all go through. I think we also need to normalize conversations that you're having financial feelings about pricing, but know that they're actual tools and structures to help you at least not let your feelings get in the way of it. And not have you feel a lot of shame around having funny feelings around money and pricing because it's a natural part of the business, but it doesn't have to hold you back.
This episode was jam-packed with info, and it's a lot to think about. But I do want to leave you with that exact quote from Susie Orman. She's a finance guru. If you don't know who she is, you should look her up. She's amazing. So this quote is from CNBC. A 25-year-old who invests $100 a month in a Roth IRA for 40 years and earns 12% average annual return, when that person retires at the age of 65, their investment will be worth just over $1 million. She didn't say bucks. I did. But not everyone starts putting away money in their 20s. You think, oh, I don't have to invest. I'm young, Orman says. If you start investing $100 a month at age 35, though, you'd only have around $300,000 by the time you reach age 65. So those 10 years just cost you $700,000, Orman points out. I mean, how much would you have to be investing later on to make up for that? So I think that Susie's pointing out the importance of this conversation. So remember these last few things before we leave you. Don't beat yourself up. Do educate yourself. And do be gentle with yourself if you're starting later. Do what you can. You got this. Okay, that's it for today, friends. I want to first thank Brian for being a stellar intern, a good pal, and for being willing to share all his learnings on his freelance journey. And I want to thank Kara, the Frugal Feminista. You should follow her, pick up a copy of her book, How to Heal Your Finances. Get a copy of all her books. They're in the show notes, folks. Well Adjusting is an Edit Audio original series. It's exec produced by Steph Colburn and Robin Hopkins. Our producer is Maria Passingham, and our production manager is Kathleen Specker. This episode was edited by Megan Hayward. Thank you to the entire Edit Audio team and to you for listening. Oh, hey, before you take out those AirPods, this show is just for entertainment. If you are in need of help, please reach out to a professional. Go ahead and get that help. You deserve it.